Hey guys, so right now we are able to clear the window using a clear command, and the next logical step is to add a draw command to render our first triangle. Of course, we are still missing a few Vulkan objects to make that happen. As usual with Vulkan, we need to tell the system as much as possible about how the frame is going to be created. This is why we are recording all those command buffers offline, so that the driver can optimize for what's going to happen. One of the main things that the driver needs to know about is all the resources that we plan to write to or read from and any dependencies between them. This is where the RenderPass object comes in. It contains a list of these resources and their dependencies, as well as information about their format, how they are going to be loaded or stored, and the expected incoming and outgoing layout. The driver should be able to use this info in order to optimize its execution. Based on the dependency graph, the driver can reorder draw commands, run them in parallel when possible, and even compress them to reduce memory bandwidth. In the simplest example, we read from vertex and index buffers and render into a color attachment, which is basically the swap chain image. Vertex and index buffers are not related to the render pass. They have their own way of binding to the pipeline, which we will see in a future video. The render pass references only images and textures. So in this case, we need to set up a render pass with a single output image. Sounds very straightforward. However, in more complex scenarios, we may need to render into a shadow map and then read from it, or we render into a G-buffer for deferred rendering and then use it as input, or we do some post-processing effect on the entire window, such as bloom or any other filter. All these cases requires changing the input and output resources. At this point, Vulkan steps in and says, "Hold it! This is too much. The fact that your render pass includes these resources is not enough. You have to tell me exactly how you are going to use them." For this purpose, we have a subpass. A subpass encapsulates all the draw commands that use the same input and output resources. Whenever something changes, we need a new subpass. We can see a couple of nice examples on Sasha Willem's website. In the first example, we have a subpass which renders into a color and depth attachments at the same time, and then uses them as input for the final render into the swap chain image, which is presented on the screen, of course. The second example is even more complex and includes three subpasses. The first one renders into a G-buffer, which includes four output attachments. Then the second pass uses them to create an intermediate frame, and then a final subpass uses that to handle transparency and create a final frame. Naturally, we are still far away from implementing something like that. In this video, we are going to create a single render pass with a single subpass. Is the render pass enough to continue? Of course not. In the true spirit of Vulkan, all the relevant information is actually split into two main objects. The render pass is the higher level object, which refers to the input and output resources in a kind of an abstract manner. When the render pass is created, we still don't know who exactly are these resources. The render pass must be connected to a frame buffer object, whose job is to provide the exact identity of these resources. If I remember correctly, I briefly mentioned the frame buffer in a previous video, and I've warned you not to confuse it with the OpenGL frame buffer. There are a few similarities, but they are not the same thing. Okay, so we are in tutorial number 12, and I'd like to start this code review by making a quick comparison of the application code between this one and the previous one, number 11, which we see right here. Okay, so this is number 11, and this is number 12, the current one, just to get a high-level view of the major changes, and then we'll dive into the details using Visual Studio. So first of all, in the init function of the Vulkan app, we can see that we have two new calls here to the Vulkan core. First of all, we create a simple render pass and we get a handle here. And then we create a frame buffer and we actually get a vector of frame buffers back. As you can see, we have two new private attributes. We have the handle of the render pass and we have a vector of the VK frame buffer. So basically we have one frame buffer for every image. We'll see that in a second. Now, as we saw in the examples from Sasha Williams' website, each scenario, each case requires its own render pass, whether this is like deferred rendering or shadow mapping or whatever, the render pass is a bit different. But I expect that for at least some time, we will be using a very simple render pass, as I explained, with a single subpass. So I decided to create this function, which creates a simple render pass, and this will allow us to reuse this code for each tutorial. Okay, so this is part of the Vulkan core. Same goes with the frame buffer, at least for now. In the future, we will need to rethink this strategy. Now, all the major changes are in the record command buffers, and we have a few major changes here that I'd like to show you. First of all, as you can see, this image sub-resource range structure is now gone, and we have a render pass begin info instead. The image range was used for the memory barriers. Remember, we had a present to clear barrier and then a clear to present barrier. So both of them are now gone, as I've mentioned at the end of the previous video. So it's very unfortunate for the barriers that their character got killed at the first and only episode that they appeared in. But of course, I'm kidding. We will use them again in the future. We had to use the barriers for layout transitions. But since the render pass is also capable of doing layout transitions, we can actually drop the barriers for now, and we will use them in the future when we need them for complex synchronization scenarios. So the two pipeline barriers are gone, and also the clear color image command. And instead, we have this begin render pass and an end render pass. So now I think it's time to jump into Visual Studio. And the way that the render pass works is that the draw command must be inside a range of a render pass, which begins with this function, command begin render pass, and then command end render pass, or CMD end render pass. So we expect any draw commands to be here. And since the render pass itself is encapsulated inside the command buffer, these two calls must be inside a begin command buffer and an end command buffer range. Okay, so all of these functions take the current command buffers, which we traverse in this for loop. So even though this doesn't seem to do anything right now because we're missing the draw commands, this actually clears the window for us, and we will see that in a second. Okay, to begin a render pass, we need to provide a command buffer, an address of a render pass begin info, and then a flag which represents the subpass contents. Now, there are a few options here, but these two are a bit too advanced for now. So we will use subpass contents in line, which basically says that the contents of the subpass are recorded in line in the primary command buffer. And if you don't remember what the primary command buffer is, you can go back to the first video on command buffers, and I go into more details there. Now, the initialization of the render pass begin info is actually split into two parts. We have this part right here, which is invariant to the for loop, okay? Everything is static here. It doesn't change inside the for loop, except the frame buffer. Whenever we begin a render pass, we must tell the system which frame buffer we are using, and we have one command buffer per image, and we have also one frame buffer per image. So we set the current frame buffer in the render pass to be the corresponding one from the frame buffer's vector. So this is the only thing that changes. Everything else can be outside the loop. So what do we have in this render pass begin info? First of all, we have the render pass handle itself, right? Because as you can see, we're not passing it in any one of these parameters. And then we have the render area, which is basically the region of the attachments of the render pass that will be affected by things like loading or storing attachments, as we will see in the creation of the render pass. And of course, any rendering which will be done must also fall only inside this render area. And the easiest way to guarantee this is by using a scissor. Of course, right now we don't really need that. So we set the starting offset to be 0, 0, and then the extent of the region is the width and height of the window. Then we have the clear values. This allows us to clear the output attachment to some color. And if we have multiple attachments, we can provide an array here. And this is the number of elements in that array. So the clear value is defined up here. And this is actually a union of a color and a depth stencil value. Okay. As you can see, we are setting the color to be the same one that we used in the previous tutorial. So let's see how to create a simple render pass. Again, this function is part of the Vulkan core. The function that does that is create render pass. It takes the logical device, an address of a render pass create info. This time, the previous one was begin info, okay? Null for the allocator, and an address of the render pass handle, which will be returned by this function. So what do we have in this render pass create info? There are basically three main things here. We have the attachments, all the resources. We have the subpasses, and we have the dependencies between the subpasses. Each one of them is actually an array as usual. So we have the address and the number of elements. So for this simple render pass, we just need one attachment for the output, one subpass, and we don't need any dependencies because we have just one subpass. So for the single attachment, we have an attachment description, and we need to provide a few bits of information. First of all, we have the format of the attachment. And in this case, because we are referring to a swap chain image, we have this swap chain surface format, which was initialized when we created the swap chain. We had this function, choose surface format and color space. So based on the selected physical device, we got the surface format and color space. So we extract the format from that. Next, we have the samples, and this is for multi-sampling. We have several options here, but right now we're not using that, so we'll simply use one bit. Then we have the load up and the store up. And this tells us how to load the attachment on the first subpass that uses it, and how to store it at the end of the last subpass that uses it. So for loading, we have several options. We can either load the attachment, or clear its contents, or tell the system that we don't care. So for the first one, the system must make sure that the contents of the attachments are preserved. In the second option, we're telling the system that not only we don't care about the contents of the resource, we are actually going to clear it. And in the third option, we're telling the system that we simply don't care because we're probably going to override the entire image. And the fact that the system is aware of our plans for this resource gives it a lot of flexibility in terms of optimizations. Remember that in OpenGL, the system doesn't know whether a GL clear command is incoming or we're going to read from this resource because everything is dynamic. We can change it on the fly during the render loop. So Vulkan paves the way for a lot of optimizations here. Now for the store operations, we can tell the system that we want to store the contents of the image to memory, or again, we don't care. In our render pass, we're telling the system that we want to clear the output image when it is loaded, and we want to store it to memory. Next, we have the exact same thing for the stencil component of the resource. And since we're not using the stencil here, we have don't care for both of them. And finally, we have the initial layout and the final layout. So this is the layout that we expect the attachment to be in when the render pass begins. In our case, it is undefined. And the final layout is the layout that the attachment will be transitioned to at the end of the render pass. So in our case, this is present source, similar to what we did with the pipeline image barriers. Next, we have the subpass, which is here. Most of what we have in the subpass description is the specification of attachments that we're going to use. Of course, all the resources that the subpass can reference are part of this array right here. First of all, we have the pipeline bind point, which can be graphics or compute. In our case, it is graphics, of course. Then we have the list of input attachments. For example, if we're sampling from a texture in a shader. Then we have the color attachments, basically the output. We have resolve, depth stencil, preserve. We're not using any of them right now. Now, in order to specify an attachment, we have to go through yet another structure called an attachment reference. And what we have here is the index of the attachment from this array. So of course, this is 0. And then the layout of the attachment during this subpass. So we have the initial layout, the final layout, and then the layout of each subpass. And this allows us to create a series of layout transitions through the render pass. So hopefully the render pass was created successfully and we return the handle to the caller. And then we call create frame buffer. Probably need to call it create frame buffers because we return a vector of frame buffer handles. And as you can see, we have to provide the render pass here as a parameter. So the render pass can be created on its own, but for the frame buffer, we must reference an existing render pass. We start by resizing the vector of frame buffers according to the number of images. This guy right now is a private attribute in the Vulkan Core class. Not sure if we really need to store it as part of the class or just allocate it here on the stack and let the caller take care of that. We'll see that in the future. Next, we traverse all the images in the swap chain. And for each one, we create a frame buffer. We have a frame buffer create info, as usual. This structure must be updated with the handle of the render pass, the number of attachments, and an array of attachments. As you can see, this is actually a pointer to an image view. So we grab the address of the corresponding image view, which we already created when the swap chain was created. Next, we have the width and height of the attachment. So if you have these values laying around, you can just plug them right here. But right now I don't keep them as part of the Vulkan core. So I use glfw get window size with the handle of the glfw window to get back the width and height of the window. And finally, the number of layers is 1 because this is a simple image. It is not multi-layered. As you can see, most of this structure can actually be pulled outside of the loop, and the only thing that changes is the pointer to the attachment. So I may do this later, or you can do it yourself. Finally, the vector is returned back to the caller. So let's see if this works. And yeah, everything seems to work correctly. So congratulations, we now have a render pass which clears the window. In the next video, we're going to create a couple of shaders. So thank you for watching and I'll see you in the next one.